Hello, everyone. Welcome to the bridge. Come on. The sun, S-U-N, is shining, and the sun, S-O-N, is shining today. Come on. I'm going to pray, and we're going to just launch into worship. Listen, don't be a spectator. Be a participator. Come on. You see, the Bible says we enter his gates with thanksgiving, into his courts with praise. Worship isn't something that you do. It's something that happens to you. But you have to start the motor. Come on. You have to turn the key to your praise and your thanksgiving to God. You got to lift your voice. Amen. King David understood this. He says, I'm going to praise you in the midst of the people. Come on. I'm going to let my voice be heard. Come on. So, Father, we thank you. We praise you. We bless you, mighty, mighty, mighty God. We thank you that you're here. You want to meet with us. You want to heal us, deliver us, set us free, save us from our sin, Lord. And we thank you. We welcome you. We honor you. And we are going to be proactive in our worship of you in Jesus' name. Amen. Can you say amen to that?
Sorrows and dead in my sin, lost without hope and no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, was redeemed, only beauty remains, and my orphan heart was given a name. My morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested in my life began, chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested in my was a moment when the lights went out, when death acclaimed its victory. The King of love had given up his life, the darkest day in history. They're on the cross that made for sinners. For every curse is blood atoned. One final breath and it was finished. But not the end we could have known. For the earth began to shake. The veil was torn. What sacrifice was made as the heavens roared? All hail King Jesus. All hail the Lord. Jesus, all hail the Savior.
love you, Lord.
Confess that over your lives.
Heartbreak is not my home. You are, death is not the end. Jesus, you are. goodbye fear, goodbye guilt, goodbye shame, goodbye pain, goodbye grave, it's a new horizon. Goodbye fear, goodbye guilt, goodbye shame, goodbye pain, goodbye grave, it's a new horizon.
Your name stands above. guys, we have open communion up front. If you feel led, just come up at any time and take communion. Amen.
Come on.
God, you are so good. Lord, we love you. We're so grateful for you, Lord, and everything that you're doing. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. May our praise bring you glory this morning, God. You deserve all the praise and all the glory and all the honor, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. And all God's people said, amen. Well, guys, welcome to the bridge. Why don't you introduce yourself to somebody you don't know? Give a couple people a hug.
Happy Sunday, everyone. You made it. You made it to church. Should give yourself a high five on that one. That's just clapping your hands when you give yourself a high five. This morning, I'm going to bring a word called, Can You Hear the Sound of Freedom? The key scripture that I'm going to be speaking from today is 2 Corinthians 3:17, and it says, Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Which another word for that is emancipation from bondage and true freedom. John 8:31 through 32 says, So Jesus was saying to the Jews who had believed him, If you abide in my word, continually obeying my teachings and living in accordance with them, then you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth regarding salvation, and the truth will set you free from the penalty of sin. So today we're going to talk about some truth, but I'm going to go ahead and pray one more time for us, because who knows, we can always use more prayer. So let's do it. Father God, we just thank you, Father, that you are here in this place, that you are not a God afar off somewhere in the universe, but you are right here in this room. And Lord, we just honor you and recognize your presence this morning. We thank you for showing up in worship in such a powerful way. And Lord, we thank you, Father God. We thank you, Father, that we're ready to receive revelation from heaven this morning. And that, Lord, we're gonna leave this place, Lord, changed and transformed by the power of your word in Jesus' name. Amen. So have any of you guys had like a fear of something, like snakes or reptiles or snails, skunks? I don't know. Everybody's got their thing. Mine was spiders, right? Do I have any spider people in the house? Okay, yes. There's one of those creatures in heaven. I'm like, God, why? Why? Eight legs, why? Why can they move so fast yet they are so small and they jump too? What the heck? A lot of questions that I'm probably not going to care about, but now I do. So my fear of spiders started when I was just a child, because we had a very specific kind of spider growing up in the state of Missouri called the brown recluse, right? It's like the black widow of the Midwest. So my sister ended up getting, Shelly right here, wave it to everybody, yay. She ended up getting bitten by a brown recluse. And it's one of those things where you can't just be like, oh, okay, just put some Windex on it. Like, you literally have to go to the hospital, and there's a whole deal, right? So she went to the hospital. So at that point, my fear of spiders became a real deal. And it literally transformed my life, right? If I saw one, I would freak out, scream, and run around the house and get my dad to kill it. Now that's my husband's job. Amen. He uses the vacuum. He's very stealthy like that. Or, heaven forbid, I had a spider web hit me in the face. Have you ever had that happen? And you're like, it's on me. I know it's on me. Where is it at? Right? And literally, before I went to bed every night, I had to, like, get a flashlight, because this is before phone flashlights, right? I'm back in the day. Lift up the sheets, check out, make sure there's no spiders hanging in there. So my life was literally changed from the encounter with the brown recluse. Isn't that amazing how fear can change everything, right? We encounter fear and we walk different, we talk different, we live different, we'll go certain places, we won't go certain places because of fear, right? So Pastor Fred eloquently talked about the fear of the Lord. Who heard that message last week? Wasn't that a good message? I need to listen to that 5 more times. And he had mentioned such amazing nuggets about how when we talk about the fear of the Lord, we're not talking about we're scared that he's got a lightning bolt ready to take us out, right? But there's an awe and a reverence. Say reverence. Reverence for the Lord. So this morning, we're going to talk more about that because I felt like God said, we're not done. There's more of this that we need to talk about it today. All right, so last week, he also mentioned that not all fear is bad fear, right? It's good to be afraid to run across the freeway, right? It's good to be, you know, not be excited to put your face on the hot stove, right? There's certain fears that are very beneficial to our life and even having a life because we don't die, right? But the fear of the Lord that we're talking about is talked about in Proverbs 1, verse 7. It's the reverent fear of the Lord that is worshiping him and regarding him as truly awesome. It is the beginning and the preeminent part of knowledge, and it's a starting point and its essence, but the arrogant fools despise skillful and godly wisdom and instruction and self-discipline. So when we're talking about the fear of the Lord, we're not talking about terror or dread. We're talking about respect and honor to our God. We're talking about being concerned about being pleasing to him because he is Lord of our life. And we're talking about not being terrified of him, but being terrified of the idea of a life without him. Amen? So there's so many facets of who our God is. And we like to put God in little boxes like he's my father, he's my homeboy, he's my buddy, right? But that's not how our God functions. He's so many things all in one, right? He's love, but yet at the same time, he is holy, right? But see, we get a misconstruing of what the word love is, don't we? I feel like it's one of the assignments of the enemy in this season is to take words like love and twist it, right? Love isn't like, oh, well, you know, you can sin all you want. You can murder my friend. It's all good because I love you. I want to be tolerant and accepting of them murdering my family because it's okay, right? No, loving someone is keeping them from doing something that is harmful to themselves or someone else, right? That's real, authentic love. You know, the same word issue that my dad and I were talking about yesterday is a lot of people get the word grace confused. Oh, do you believe in that grace gospel? That grace where you can do whatever the heck you want? Well, that's not a biblical picture of grace, right? We receive grace so that we can walk in right standing with God. Amen? All right, so God's going to give us some wisdom and revelation about that today, okay? So also, we're going to talk about the fact that we kind of live in an interesting day where a lot of the things of the Lord, we treat it as common, right? It's like, oh, we're just going to church. We're just going to go hang out with Jesus, you know? Like, I'm just going to crawl in here, and I'm going to listen to Travis sing. Oh, good job. Thumbs up, Travis. Way to go. You should do American Idol. Way to go, man. And we don't even realize we're in the presence of a living God, right? Literally the creator of the entire universe, right, that created the most delicate flower and the most complex DNA is here in this room with us today. Is he limited to this room? No. But we have to approach him with awe and reverence. Just think about how we'd be acting if somebody like famous were in the room, right? Is it Mahomes that won the thing, the Super Bowl? Sorry, I am so sporty, you can't even believe it. I get it from my dad. No, I'm just kidding. We're not sports people, that's okay. God loves us anyway. But literally, like if somebody like that was in the room or the King of England was in the room, everybody would be like, oh my gosh, the King's of England. Get a picture, get a selfie, let's get a signature. Oh my gosh, like let me take our pictures and put it all over Facebook. How excited we are that they're here, right? And we get so excited about them. And then we walk in like, oh, hi God. Hey, oh, you're still here? Okay, right? We can treat God like he's small potatoes compared to those people. But we all know that's not the truth, amen? You know, and I'm guilty of that too. You know, I can get very comfortable in the presence of God and just think it's no big deal. But the great news today is we can make a choice to ask God for his grace to start walking in awe and reverence of who he really is. I love, one of my favorite stories in the Bible is the burning bush. That's in Exodus 3, verse 2. And it says, "The angel of the Lord appeared to him in a blazing flame of fire from the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush was on fire, yet it was not consumed. So Moses said, 'I must turn away from the flock and see this great sight, why the bush is not burned up.' Then the Lord saw that he turned away from the flock to look, and God called him from the midst of the bush and said, 'Moses, Moses.' And he said, 'Here I am.' Then God said, 'Do not come near. Take off your sandals of your feet out of respect, because the place on which you're standing is holy ground.' And then he said, 'I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob.' Then Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God." Moses feared the Lord because he was encountering the awesomeness and power of who God is. And notice that he actively had to approach, right? The bush wasn't chasing him around. He had to stop and turn. So it is with the fear of the Lord. We have to choose to walk in the fear of the Lord. Amen? The fear of the Lord is critical for us to have a deep and intimate relationship with God, because he is holy. He is pure. He cannot associate with things that are unclean, right? So if we're not walking in the fear and the reverence for who he is, we're never going to have that depth of relationship with him. Not because he doesn't want it, but because we're not willing to do what it takes to get it. Amen? Let's talk about some signs that indicate whether or not we're walking in the fear of the Lord. Do we approach him in awe and reverence? Like, let's say I invited myself over to your house, as I do from time to time. Patience is still being worked out in my life. So I come over to your house and I knock on the door, and you answer the door all excited to see me, as you would be. And I'm on my phone and I barely look up at you. I'm like, "Oh, okay, it took you a while to open the door." And I just waltzed in, and you're like, "Oh, okay." And I go in and I'm just putting my foot on your feet on your furniture, and you're trying to talk and engage with me, and I'm just on my phone. And then and then I stop and I say, "Hey, can you get me a snack? I need a snack right now." And then I go back to my phone, right? I'm like, "Oh, and by the way, can you wash my car real quick? That it really needs to be cleaned up. So like, if you could take care of that," right? We would probably not be friends for very long. You're like, "That Abby girl is a weirdo. She like comes over and takes over your life and messes up all your stuff," right? Sometimes we talk and approach to God that way, don't we? We treat him like Santa Claus. "I'm making my list and hopefully you're checking it twice, God," right? We treat him like a vending machine. "You're here to meet my needs or bail me out of bad situations." That's not who our God is. Yes, he will rescue us, and yes, he will help us, but then we are limiting our relationship with him, right? There is so much more that we can access with him. Hebrews 12:28 says, "Therefore, since we receive a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us show gratitude and offer to God pleasing service and acceptable worship with reverence and awe. For our God is indeed a consuming fire." The next one is, do we tolerate sin? Is that a big word right now? Tolerate? Better be tolerant. You're not tolerant enough. I'm not going to tolerate you, but you better be tolerant of me. Right? Am I the only one that's experienced that? Do we hate what is evil or do we love it? Can we ask that hard question? Matthew 6:24 said, no one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. It's interesting. I always thought that was about money, right? But actually the definitions, all the definitions are money, possessions, fame, status. And this is the one here, guys. Whatever is valued more than the Lord. Whoo! Yeah. Proverbs 8:13 says, the reverent fear and worshipful awe of the Lord includes the hatred of evil. Pride and arrogance and the evil way and the perverted mouth I hate. You know, I think a lot of times why we're struggling with addiction or sin that we feel like we can't overcome is because we just like it. Or we love it, right? Have you ever had one of those conversations? I can't get over it. I just can't get over it. I can't get over it. I can't stop doing it. I can't. I tried. I prayed. I fasted. I did all the things. Well, do you like it? Right? You know, do we flee? So it's so important when we recognize if we like it, we've got to acknowledge that. Yes, I like it. Now, God, I need your help to set me free from that lust of the flesh. Right? Okay. This is a good one. Do we flee from sin or do we welcome it into our home? You know, it's so easy to think about, you know, oh, well, it doesn't matter what I do if nobody sees me, or it doesn't really matter, you know, that I'm doing these little things because it's really not a big deal. It's not as bad as what so-and-so is doing, right? So we start making all these excuses, right? Here's one. I am a mature Christian and I can handle it. Woo! That's probably the most immature Christian thing I could say. Right? We don't have to walk in sin to empathize with unbelievers. Right? I had a guy I knew at my Christian university who, he said, well, the reason why I have to listen to this awful music is because I need to understand how to empathize with my generation. And I go, does that work with porn? Do I have to watch porn to understand what people are struggling with? Did Jesus have to do those things in order to set people free? No. So it's so important we don't let those traps, it's a trap of the enemy, get us going down that way. You know, we can think, oh, it doesn't matter what I'm watching. It doesn't matter what I'm listening to. Oh, that doesn't affect me. I just listen to the beat. That used to be my generation. We just like the beat, right? That doesn't affect my family. You know what I learned as I became a parent? Do as I say and don't do as I do doesn't work. Real quick. But mom, you do it. Close your eyes. Right? It affects our family. Even if they're not participating with you, it's affecting the atmosphere of your home. You're opening doors to things that are going to affect not only your children, but your children's children's children. Right? It's not about when you have a family, it's not about just what am I doing? It's how am I being an example? Right? How am I helping my children to face whatever is in store in this future generation? You know, I think a great test for that, this is an old book. Whoever read In His Steps? It's a really, really old book back in the day. Sorry, it's not that old, Dad. Sorry. It's a semi, not recent book that was incredible. It was about this community of people that decided to use the question, what would Jesus do? Before they would do whatever they were going to do. And then they had that whole bracelet thing for a while in like the 2000s or whatever. And I thought about that. If we applied that question, what would Jesus do? How different would our life be? Would Jesus yell at my kids right now? Probably not. Right? So it's so important for us to think and apply those things. Because the truth is, Jesus is always with us. Right? He always sees, right? And there is now no condemnation in Christ Jesus. Okay, so let's not get this twisted this morning, all right? But when we do wrong, we own it and we repent. Amen? That's the difference, okay? You know, do we include God in our daily choices and decisions, asking for his wisdom, or are we depending on our wisdom, which is a form of arrogance? I have been very guilty of that, right? I'm so smart in my little pea brain. I've got it all figured out. I've got all my charts and my organizational things. I got this, God. Don't worry. Just take a break for a little bit. Go, you know, focus on the universe moving and the things that you do up there, right? And here I miss on an opportunity of wisdom that God wants to put in my life that could help me avoid so many difficulties in this life. I remember before COVID happened, I've heard so many testimonies of people who said, my job changed or this happened. Thank God that happened before COVID, because they were asking the Lord about his will in their life. Amen? So important and so crucial, especially with days that come ahead here. James 4, 13 through 15 says, come now and pay attention to this, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to such and such a city and spend a year there and carry out on our business and make profit. Yet you do not know the least thing about what may happen in your life tomorrow. What is secure in your life? You are merely a vapor, a puff of smoke or a wisp of steam from a cooking pot that is visible for a little while and then vanishes into thin air. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and we will do this or that. Amen? You know, it's so important to remember who he is, right? He's the creator. He put the very air in our lungs. He has everything we need when it comes to wisdom. So let's give him the opportunity every day to speak into our life. Amen? The next one is, are we honoring the Lord with our example? Matthew 5:16 says, let your light shine before men in such a way that they may see your good deeds and moral excellence and recognize and honor and glorify your Father who is in heaven. You know, Jesus isn't in the flesh on earth right now today, is he? So who is representing him? Us, right? And right now, I'd say he doesn't have the greatest reputation in our nation. And I think that is because the church has not been being the church, and they've been living with all sorts of compromise, right? Why isn't everybody already saved and this deal is done? Because the church is not being the church, amen? And I'm preaching to myself this morning, so if you're getting nervous, I'm nervous with you. We are on this trip together. You know, and as we're living, you know, are we just acting one way in church on Sunday? And then are we just acting a whole other way during the week? Somebody cut me off in the Starbucks line. They didn't make my latte right again. Oh, Jesus, if we're losing our salvation over a latte, we need help. Right? They took my parking spot. They sat in my seat at church. If you have a seat, it's time to move. Come on. If we're letting that kind of stuff happening, we are way off base. Okay? So maybe some of you next week, we need try a new seat, see what happens. You may get a whole new revelation. Right? Whoo! So are we honoring him with our example? You know, would we be comfortable acting the way that we do out there in here? In front of Pastor Justin. You know? And you know what? We are. We're in front of our Savior all the time. He sees. Are other fears controlling us, or do we allow the awe of who our God is to overcome all fear? You know, a beautiful quote by Derek Prince said, what you fear is your God. You could chew on that for a week, huh? You know, there's so many fears I could address. Fear of failure, fear of death, you know, fear of, you know, bad hair days, whatever is your deal or my deal. Okay, I get worried about bad hair days, okay? But the main one I feel like God wants me to focus on is the fear of man. Proverbs 29:25 says, "The fear of man brings a snare or a trap. Whoever trusts in and puts his confidence in the Lord will be exalted and safe." Galatians 1:10 says, "Am I now trying to win the favor and approval of men or of God? Or am I seeking to please someone? If I were trying to be popular with men, I would not be a bondservant of Christ." God wants to free us from the fear of man. But in order to do that, we have to invite the fear of the Lord in our life, right? Because it's kind of like with the sun, right? When the sun comes out, we don't see the stars, right? It doesn't mean the stars, like, they moved away for a while. They'll be back in about 24. It's all good. But it's so bright, you can't see the stars anymore, right? When we are so in awe of the creator of the universe and everything that he is, we don't have time for other stuff, do we? We don't get distracted by that person that took our latte in line. Right? Well, they must have needed more than me, bless God. Hope you like 12 shots. No, just kidding. If you're doing 12 shots, we're going to pray for you after service. Because I think that's a past the legal limit, okay? The next one is, are we walking in boldness and confidence in the Lord? Proverbs 14:26 says, "In the fear of the Lord, there is strong confidence, and his children will have refuge." You know, there's a really amazing movie that came out recently. It's called The Sound of Freedom. I highly, highly, highly recommend that you go and see that. You know, you know, I had a little apprehension about seeing it because, again, it's very difficult subject matter. But then I realized, you know what? If these children can experience this 24 hours a day, I sure as heck can give an hour and 30 minutes of my time to be aware. Amen? We can't be asleep right now, church. You know, how did we get here? Where 85,000 children have come across our border, and they are, no one knows where. They've disappeared. How is America the number one consumer of child trafficking and child porn? How is America a place where children's bodies are being mutilated in the name of gender identity? How is America a place where evil is being called good and good is being called evil? It's because we lost the fear of the Lord. And I'm not talking about people in the world, church. We, the church, have lost the fear of the Lord along the way because this would have never been allowed to happen. You know, we've tolerated things way too much for much too long. And we haven't been bold to take a stand in truth and love because we've been too afraid of man's opinion. You know, it's so easy to get obsessed with being liked or accepted by others, caring more about what other people think than what God thinks. And we've tolerated sin in our own lives because we want that those things way more than we want to see a change in these issues. The tagline for the film, which really kind of rung in my spirit and I was just processing it, is, "God's children are not for sale." And as I thought about it, I was like, yes, this is 100% about these children that are being trafficked and abused and killed. But it's also about us, God's children. Are we for sale, church? Are we willing to trade our destiny for a bowl of beans? When I'm talking about a bowl of beans, it's that story of Esau, who traded his birthright for a bowl of beans. You know, if God's people were not for sale, we wouldn't be where we're at right now, honestly. Because the enemy found our price. This is how much I have to give you for you to be distracted. This is what I need to do to you to get you off track. Are we for sale? We have to choose. Right now, there's a choice before us. Are we going to continue on like nothing's happening and stick our head in the sand? Or are we going to wake up and take a stand against it? I think we're at a very similar hour, like during the Holocaust, where the ash was falling on people's heads and they wouldn't believe that it could be human bodies. Right? You ask people, we didn't believe it. We couldn't believe that that's what was happening. We cannot afford to turn a blind eye to what's happening in our nation right now. And we cannot tolerate sin in our own lives because it's distracting us from what we're supposed to do. So are we on sale or are we on fire? Are we on fire with the awe of who our God is compared to what's happening around us? Are we on fire like David facing Goliath saying, I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel whom you have defied. Like Moses approaching Pharaoh saying, let my people go. Or like Esther saying, as she risked death to go to the king to rescue her people, if I die, I die. I believe God wants to visit not only our church, but the church with a greater revelation of the fear of the Lord. But not only a revelation, but an encounter. But the first step is to repent. I don't know about you, but I do not want my children growing up in a place where kids are being butchered like this, where they don't know if they're a girl or a boy, where they're at the mercy of politicians and people whose whole focus in life is gain and greed. I want them to live in a generation that is truly free. So it's kind of a trick, right? The sound of the freedom is not doing whatever you want. The sound of freedom is fearing the Lord and obeying him. Amen? So I want us to respond to this message today, because this is nothing but words if we don't respond. So let's go ahead and stand up, please. I want you to go ahead and put your hands out in just a posture to receive, please. Father God, we don't ever want to take your word lightly. And we repent for how we've made you small in our life, in our world, in our nation. God, we repent for how we've allowed ourselves to be distracted and filled with excuses for why we're not obeying you. Lord, we're not just repenting for ourselves. We're repenting for the future of our nation. We're repenting for the future of the church, God. And Lord, we're repenting for our children and our grandchildren, God. We just declare with our own mouths, I am not for sale. And I receive the fear of the Lord. Lord God, we just pray that you would light us on fire. Let everything that's chaff in our life, all the junk, let it burn away. Let it be purged away. Lord, all of our wrong motives or ideas or thoughts or vows that are not from you, Lord, purge that with the fire of the Holy Spirit this morning. And Lord, let us burn for you. Let us burn for you, God. Let us not be satisfied with the bowl of beans anymore, God. But Lord, let us be hungry and desperate for you. Lord, we just lay it down. all the things that we put before you, all the mammon in our life, God, we lay it at your feet, God. And Lord, we say we surrender. We surrender, God. Lord, we pray that our heart would break for what breaks yours. That our heart would burn for what burns yours. And that, Lord, we would not tolerate sin any longer. Lord, we can't do this without your help. That's where the grace comes in. We ask for your help, God, to change our thinking, to change our attitude about who you are and about who we are in you, Jesus. Lord, we thank you, Jesus. And Lord, we cry out for a miracle for our nation, Jesus. Don't pass over us, God. Don't forget us. Don't leave us behind. Have mercy on our nation, Jesus. Lord, it's like we don't even know sometimes how to talk to people. They're so confused. But Lord, you always knew what to say to cut through what was being said and get to the heart of a person. So Lord, we just say we're willing. We're willing, God. Use us to be your conduit of truth. Help us to be bold. Lord, we pray that you would burn away any fear of man that we've submitted ourselves to. We repent for the fear of man. And Lord, we receive the fear of God. Lord, we thank you, Father, for the sound of freedom. Because Lord, you've had enough. You've had enough of these little ones screaming out for help. So Lord, we ask that your church would arise in this hour and that your enemies would be scattered. And that, Lord, that these children would be wrecked, Lord, rescued. And that, Lord, we would be wrecked. We invite you to wreck us, Holy Spirit, where we cannot continue with business as usual. We cannot pretend these things are not happening. But Lord, we confront it with truth and with love. Lord, we thank you, Holy Spirit. We thank you, Lord, that you love us so much. Teach us how to walk in awe of you. Teach us how to let you eclipse everything else in our life. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you for more of your fire right now. Just more of your fire. Flood through this place. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Lord. To take a moment with your Heavenly Father. He's here in this place. His tangible presence. He's always here, but his tangible presence is in this place. I want you to take a moment with your own mouth. If there's areas that he wants you to repent of, I want you to take this holy moment before the Lord and say those things to him.
I'm going to ask us to do something before we leave this building. one of the lines that statements that you made, Abby, was, is there something in our life that is more valuable than our relationship with God? And I felt like I just saw people walking forward carrying in their hands that thing that's more important or more valuable and just laying it down in the front. We used to have what we called altar calls. And that's where you went and did business with God. But I want to just ask you, if there's something in your life, and you know what? You say, well, what if I pick it up again tomorrow? Well, then you ask God to help you to lay it down again. But if you want to do a prophetic act, whatever it would be, maybe it's the fear of man, maybe it's a habitual sin, maybe it's a just something that somehow in your life is more important than who God is to you. And I want you to do this. I want you to think about what that is. Look at it as if you're carrying it in your hand. And I want you just to come forward. You can just come forward, lay it down in front of the Lord, and then just go right back to your seat. If you'd like to do that, I want to invite you to do that right now. Just say, I just want to come and lay this down. I'd like our prayer team to come up to the front right now. I want us to do one more thing. If we're going to see the fear of the Lord come once again in the church and in America, it's going to be because we follow Jesus' words in John 15. Jesus said this, greater love is no one than this, that one lay down his life for his friends. Greater love is no one than this, that one lay down his life for his friends. You just laid something down. But the most important thing you can lay down is to lay down your life. That means where you're going to go, what you're going to do. What are you going to do next weekend? What are you going to do next Saturday? What do you lay down your, that's what Jesus did. He came to earth. He laid down all his rights as God. He never changed. He was still God while he was on the earth. He didn't stop being God, but he laid down his rights and privileges for the sake of how much he loved you and me. So let's together right now, let's just lift our own life before the Lord. When I'm talking about your life, and I'm not just talking about your physical life. I'm talking about your future. I'm talking about what you want in life compared to what God wants in your life. So, Lord, we just lift our life to you because we want to walk in the love of God. And there's a nation that needs to see a people who have laid down their life for their friends, laid down their life for their neighbors, laid down their life for their coworkers, laid down their life for their family members that don't know you, laid down their life for the strangers that they will meet in the weeks ahead. Turn this summer into a summer of the manifestation of the love of God through our lives, not somebody else, through me. Let us be like John Wesley, who said, I just set myself on fire and people come to watch me burn. God set us on fire so that people come to the light of Jesus. God, we pray that in Jesus' name, amen and amen. If you need prayer for anything, I'd like to talk to someone, we have several amazing prayer ministers here who are waiting to minister to you. Let me pray a blessing over you as you go. Wasn't that powerful? It's like, it's one thing when, you know, you're the dad that's supposed to be anointed and then you sit under the anointing of your child. And it's coming another direction. So good, Abby. So great. Let's seal this in our hearts. Father, we thank you for the word of God today that was more than just nice phrases and catchy things or even funny statements. We thank you for the word that has pierced through our hearts. As your word says, it will go forth and will not return void, but it will accomplish what it's supposed to do. Seal these words in our life and send us out into this world that desperately needs an example of Jesus. We pray that in Jesus' name, amen. And amen. Make sure you hug at least 100 people on the way out. Tell them how much you appreciate them. In the meantime, we'll see you next week or tomorrow night, men. We'll see you then.